On? We're good? Okay. My name is Tom Herbert. I'm going to talk about a topic today, real-time IoT networking on the internet. And the quote I chose for the presentation, where the physical world meets the virtual world. And a couple of people asked me about the significance of the picture, so I'll give a little background. So this is obviously Michelangelo's rendition of God giving life to Adam in the Sistine Chapel. And the interesting thing about this is you notice that Adam on the right, or yeah, left, on the left is kind of recessed, and his hand is in a recessed position, and God is very forthright in giving Adam life and kind of reaching out to him. So in some sense, Adam represents the real world. God represents the virtual world. And it's not really that much of a coincidence. If you look at the background, it looks kind of like a brain, which reminded me of Google Brain. So kind of correlates a little bit. There we go. Okay, so this talk is not about XDP. Although I did wear the shirt. Not about BBR, not about net filter, TC, busy polling, packet steering, zero copy, not about anything actually relating to actual code. We've covered that in depth. But it kind of is about an emerging use case where I think most of these things become very applicable. So one thing to, that's important to remember, all of this work we're doing in the development actually has a point, which is to put into a system to solve interesting problems. So I want to go back to something that I, a slide basically I had at the last NetDev, which I call the latency continuum. And this describes kind of the world in terms of networking latency. So on the left, we have the data center. Nowadays, we're talking microsecond latencies, all the fancy congestion control algorithms for the data center, zero copy, RDMA, what have you. Goal is to drive that down to very low latency so we can do things like high perform, HPC, HFT, what have you. On the far other extreme, on the internet, we still have things like going through satellites, long links. Latency can be in the hundreds of milliseconds. In a lot of cases, it really doesn't matter if you're watching a video, it can be buffered, so you don't really see these latencies. Humans interacting with computers, quarter millisecond latency, not too extreme. And the data center, obviously, machines interacting with machines trying to solve a tightly coupled computing problem, latency critical. So the one, though, that I'm most interested today is kind of this middle range, which is in the tens of milliseconds latency. And this is going to appear more and more, I believe, in the real world when we start interacting with real devices that have response times that are needed in the order of milliseconds. So the motivation for this, we can kind of represent with a graph. And the way this works is on the x-axis, we have criticality. This is basically how critical is it to get this right. And it starts from the origin, which is not critical, it doesn't matter if it doesn't work or doesn't run. And we can go all the way to the right, which is a matter of life and death. If we don't get this data there, or if it's incorrect, cars may crash or the sky may fall, something bad happens. And on the vertical axis, we have complexity. And again, this starts from the simplest Hello World program, probably no complexity, all the way up to and incredible levels of artificial intelligence. So the way the kind of compute space pans out is, so we started with a general purpose computing, which had some elements of both complexity and criticality. It's pretty flexible, but limited in both axes. Cloud, I think, solves a lot of the complexity problems, artificial intelligence. So nowadays, we can upload a video, say, to Facebook, and run a whole bunch of computer vision, artificial intelligence algorithms, and basically annotate all of that video, what's happening, who's in it, requires an incredible amount of compute power, and we basically can build data centers for that purpose. On the other extreme, for criticality, these have historically been kind of embedded systems. What I like to think of is avionics in an airplane. It's incredibly critical to get it right. And typically, or historically in engineering, the way we build systems like that is to make them very simple, foolproof, have fail-safe, what have you. So moving forward, though, what we're starting to see are more and more applications where we need both of these in the same package. So this is somehow combining this critical function and complexity and putting these together in the same solution. And kind of the poster child of this is autonomous vehicles. If you think about what an autonomous vehicle actually has to do, it's inherently a complex problem. It has to be able to interpret road conditions, identify objects on the fly, a lot of different things, a lot of machine learning, a lot of artificial intelligence is involved. Still a hard problem, not really even completely solved. But on the other hand, these are obviously life-critical systems. If your autonomous car makes a mistake, or even any driver, then you know people crash and can get hurt. So we're starting to see this kind of convergence of criticality and complexity. So the characteristics of these devices, they are typically deployed in the field. So these are real IoT sort of devices. And going back to my point about the latency continuum, we need orders of 10 milliseconds or 50 milliseconds, we're figuring, to get the response time of a real device from, a command. That also must include the control path, by the way. So when we think about, an autonomous vehicle establishing a connection to an infrastructure, if it's important to get the latency down, the connection itself has to have the same kind of latency characteristics. So we can't spend 200 milliseconds, for instance, trying to establish a secure connection to an infrastructure if the infrastructure has to tell us about some emergency situation that we have to respond on quickly. So control path is always going to be, or very often going to be, in this critical latency path. This will be predominantly wireless world, often mobile. We've already seen a couple cases of this in the Verizon talk of a vehicle moving through various cells. Cells will probably get smaller, so that will happen more often. It's kind of a given, but these have to be highly reliable, highly available, highly secure. These are devices in the real world. They are not protected by a firewall. They're not behind or in a data center infrastructure. They're out there, in a sense, by themselves, so they have to take all of the normal systems problems and put them into one device. And as I mentioned, artificial intelligence, machine learning, these kind of go hand in hand as part of these solutions. So we can draw a few conclusions from the requirements. So one is proximity to the problem. So a lot of these devices to help IoT or even the IoT devices themselves, the services need to be co-located or very close to where the action is, I like to say. One of the reasons is kind of simple. Speed of light becomes a physical limitation. So 5G guys, for instance, have a requirement or an expectation to have 1 millisecond round trip time for an application. 1 millisecond means 100 kilometers or something around that. So we can't go halfway around the world and expect to have a few milliseconds response time. So we need to get things close. In that vein, it's also very likely that we have minimum number of hops. So the more networking hops you have, the more latency goes up, reliability goes down, security becomes harder. So we'll see a lot of applications having basically one or maybe two hops. And again, this is going to have a lot to do with proximity. Also, a lot of these applications will have very short range. So this is where we get into the concept of microcells and even more locality. So we're seeing, for instance, in some of the short range radio that's going to be deployed in public infrastructure for traffic, probably up to 500 meters range, maybe even less. So the radio, there's several protocols coming out. Wave is wireless access in vehicular environments. This is based on the IEEE 802.11p standards. That's predominantly what's kind of being deployed in the early, at least traffic scenarios. 5G is very promising for an IoT protocol. They are also working on not just normal 5G, which is typical cellular, but an automobile, automobile form of it, which would be short-range radio. One of the things that 5G guys have figured out is, in kind of this new IoT world, it's not enough to be going to a base station and back. Base stations, kind of the antennas, are not necessarily located close to the action, so you can go many kilometers in rural areas. So they want to have a protocol or a wire format, at least, where 5G devices can actually talk to each other direct, so vehicle-to-vehicle or vehicle-to-infrastructure. A couple others, white space radio is more an interesting use of the frequency spectrum. From, I guess, a software point of view at least a hardware point of view, I guess we're hoping that software-defined radio can make most of this not somewhat transparent to us. So we have basically radio connections and we can communicate and get the low latency. Networking, there are obviously going to be many characteristics of this. If we have a low range limit, that means concurrent devices connected may be somewhat limited, so there's some advantages there. The data rates, at least initially, tend to be typically low, and this is also kind of falls in line with the concept of having safety critical information. So typically we don't want to be having to send video over these links. They would be more low bit rate, but critical bit rate, extremely low loss. A couple more conclusions. From a networking point of view, IPv6, I think, is kind of where we have to go. And most of the proposals seem to be along those lines. There may be cases where we have even networking less protocols or no networking protocols. So some of the IEEE protocols seem to be, I guess they consider them so critical, they might not even need networking. Can do it all at L2. And for mobility, handoff between various base stations or various uplink points is going to be critical. Similarly, with transport protocols, these are a little bit different. So safety protocols, if I'm telling you, for instance, stop your car because you're about to hit somebody, that's a very urgent, very important message, and I may not even wait for an acknowledgement. So it's very likely we're doing something like forward error correction, can keep sending the same command. I have an example of how the response actually works in that case in a minute. All of this, TCP, probably overkill for this sort of thing. In normal networking, we'd expect some sort of UDP-based protocol with various characteristics to do things like FEC and what have you. Security is going to be super critical. You can think of in terms of IPsec, DTLS. I'm sure the layer 2, the network may have its own security. I suspect that if we get down to short cells, short-range cells, and a vehicle or say an airplane or whatever, passing through these cells at a very high rate, at any given time, you'd only be connected to a cell for maybe even just a few seconds. That's not enough time every time you enter a cell to renegotiate anything. So the IP connectivity, transport connection, security have to follow the vehicle in this case from cell to cell in order to make sure that we can always talk for those critical safety protocols and what have you. It also creates some other interesting problems. So if I have an IP address assigned to, say, a vehicle, and there's obviously ways you could do this. You could have the VIN number, for instance, would be a unique number, somehow convert that into an IPv6 address. That's an easy way to go. But obviously, as my car drives around from point to point, if somebody's spoofing the network and they see that IP address, they can correlate that to me, and now I have no privacy, so my location is basically compromised. So we're going to need to obfuscate somehow both the layer 2 and layer 3 addresses, and presumably there'll be rotation and things like that. So again, this is kind of an artifact. When we're out in the wild, out in the real world, we have to assume no security or no inherent security. Somebody's always spoofing this, and compromising that security and privacy could have dire consequences. Denial of service, again, we have to consider what happens when somebody's trying to jam radio or spoofing packets or what have you. So we need a lot of denial of service mitigation. So a little more on at least one kind of context. So I do talk about traffic a lot. It's kind of the obvious use case, but there's going to be a lot more. But we see with especially the uptick of autonomous vehicles and all the automobile manufacturers are thinking about this. It's easy enough to frame this in terms of real automotive traffic. So this is a picture of an intersection. I'm not sure where it is, maybe New York or Chicago, some busy city. And all of the pointers there, those are inputs to this device. And this is real physical world input. Vehicles have their own sensors and they can provide input to, say, a roadside unit, which is a device on the side of the road that might be managing this intersection. We also want to talk to phones, smartphones, what have you. They can provide information. Cameras are going to be popular, radar, once we solve the privacy problems. There's also other sensors, inductance loops, weather, light conditions, traffic signals can give input. So all of this kind of forms the real world input for the problem. And then the things that are circled are kind of the meta inputs. So these would be coming from, say, a cloud, if we had some emergency situation in the city or some attempt to do load balancing of vehicular traffic across the city. So all of this becomes input to the system, and then correspondingly there's output. And the outputs, as you might guess, we could output instructions to autonomous vehicles. We might buzz somebody's personal phone if they're about to get hit by a car. Audio-visual warning, coordinated traffic signals. And then again, there's kind of this meta output, which is stuff going back into the cloud. So what you can see from these two pictures, there's actually a lot of various input-output happening. It's very different from a data center server, which basically has one connection to the rest of the world, and that's its all of its input and all of its output. In this case, we have networking back to the cloud. We have this short-range networking, talking to local devices. We have physical sensory input, all kinds of stuff happening. So the goal of all this, though, obviously, is to take that input, process it, and then produce something intelligent on output. Tell cars to stop or tell them to go, like I said, buzz pedestrians, what have you, control the traffic like signals. So bringing this down back to Linux, what does this mean? So clearly from the problem that we posed, building a system that's extremely reliable, secure, minimal downtime and solving the upgrade problem in the field is going to be critical. On the networking side, more specifically, obviously the device drivers become important, how to schedule networking with processes in order to get guaranteed latency requirements. We also have to consider that the end systems could pretty much be anything. So we already know IoT has a lot of low-end stuff. So when it's low-end, low power becomes important, compressed protocols, IPv6 low-pan, things like that. So your Raspberry Pi actually makes for, that's not even really truly low-end anymore, but a fairly nice device. But on the other hand, we can also foresee higher-end systems being deployed in the field. So my intersection example, if we're bringing in video into a device, it's not exactly something that we can easily process on a wimpy CPU. These are typically things that require GPUs, FPGAs, or a lot of CPUs. We already see that in a lot of self-driving cars. So it's kind of a mix of stuff we'll see. But they all have the same similar properties. If there's a real-time element to make decision-making, then we need that in the networking stack to be reflected. Containers are likely. The other thing is thinking about the difference between OS and kernel. So if we think of kernel as just the actual networking stack and the rest of the kernel as we canonically think about it, we also have to think about the larger OS. And in IoT, the larger OS will become more important. There's a significant amount of code that we need in user space to deal with, say computer vision, which is a complex problem, but we can't have every application doing it. So it effectively becomes the OS. So now we have the extended OS and how to get the OS and the kernel to work together, I guess kind of like Android in a sense, but for IoT and for real time is going to be one of the challenges. Like I said, process scheduling, so priority is critical. We may need to look at real-time Linux in some sense, although real-time might be, depends on the kind of the real-time, what real-time means. Real-time means different things in different contexts. Thinking about optimizations, simplicity and robustness is greater than micro-optimizations. User programmability, so I won't mention XDP, but something like that is typically better than proprietary hardware features. And upgradability is going to be more important than raw performance in some sense. I did want to mention one trend, I think, that not just affects this sort of application, but networking in general, which is really artificial intelligence. So IoT and AI are kind of mentioned in the same sentence. Sometimes I think they're just buzzwords for marketing. But actually, there's some rationale behind it. Thinking about how this is going to impact networking and even low-level, say, in this crowd. So one thing we've already seen is people applying machine learning for congestion control algorithms. There's Remy from MIT, and that's kind of interesting. And actually, I wonder if BBR may be the last human-written congestion control algorithm, which would be cool. So I think that algorithms being written by machines based on machine learning is one trend. We also have already seen at least one reference to using machine learning to do denial of service. I would view this as we have a lot of data coming in, throw it into some machine learning algorithms, spit out a denial of service attack signature or mitigation or what have you. There's probably a lot of applicability in this sort of taking a running system, using the data for machine learning training, outputting a better system. So we might see a lot of that. But the one that it might be more relevant in the short term is a little simpler. How do we model communications after humans? And I'll give you an example of why this is kind of relevant. So this is networking interacting with the physical world, so artificial intelligence becomes natural. And I do think that, or at least I hope in the next NetDev, there might be one or two talks around how we're applying artificial intelligence and machine learning to Linux kernel. So I have a couple of examples that show kind of maybe the uniqueness or the problem statement. So this first one is, say we have a large crowd and people have smartphones and we have a networking device that's very close to this smart crowd and we're talking to various people and we want to identify who's who. So maybe we see some hazard that one of these people is about to get hit by a meteorite or something. So how do we determine this? So if we have the devices give us GPS, that's kind of the historical thing. So the devices are receiving GPS. They can just give us the signal or the interpretation of it. So a public GPS has an accuracy of about 7 to 8 meters. So it's fairly granular. Usually we want it to be supplemented. So that'll get us down to some part of this crowd. Of course, that's can be compromised because somebody else could easily say, I have a device and I'm at this location. They can compromise their stack and basically lie saying, yeah, actually, so our attacker over there is kind of cheating the system saying that somebody is where they're really not. So triangulation of the signal and some other techniques, people have been able to get this down to a much narrower kind of field of vision. Still not able to identify individuals, but at least getting it down that we know somebody in that very general specific vicinity actually probably is the person. So what we really want to do, though, is correlate basically what we hear, which is the thing over the network, with what we see. So if we're tracking that person there, what we'll see is that the device or the location that we're getting from the network will change if they move. So we can correlate their behavior with a network signal. So this is kind of making networking and physical world kind of merging. So example number two, actually non-technical, but it's based on teaching my 16-year-old son how to drive. And this is a fascinating case study, actually, in both machine learning and really communications also. So trying to establish a protocol with a 16-year-old is an interesting task. So if you have a 16-year-old, you know what I'm talking about. 16-year-olds, gleeful, happy. And I'm going to compare them to the Terminator. So this is not random, actually. So I don't know if you saw recently, one of the futurists at Google said that AI capabilities will exceed human intelligence by 2029, which I don't know if it's meant to be that way, but that's also the same year that the Terminators rose in the Terminator movie. So there's a lot of interesting comparisons, actually, between a teenager and autonomous vehicle in current state, which I'll call the Terminator. So both are intelligent. I'll give you that. They're intelligent in different ways. Obviously, machines are, in some sense, faster. But even a 16-year-old has the benefit of 16 years of general experience and a couple hundred million years of evolution. So both I would classify as level 3 autonomy in the taxonomy of self-driving cars. So basically, they can drive, but at some point, we have to take over because they're not quite there. Trusting our lives to both of them actually is a leap of faith currently. And one interesting thing is in both cases, external input actually can mitigate the above point. So here's an example of kind of a script that I had actually with my son Andy, kind of close to reality. It's been modified for dramatic content. So basically, we're going to drive to the store. He has his learner's permit. First question he asks, where do I need to go? Okay, take a left and take a right. That's what I say. And he goes, uh-huh. So that's a typical act for a 16-year-old. Okay, so we're driving along. Okay, change lanes. He turns the blinker on. I will take the blinker as an implicit act, so I don't actually need an act from him. So we continue driving, and there's a stop sign coming up. So I say, okay, start slowing down. You have a stop sign. No response. Okay, stop. No response. Stop. No response. Stop. And he stops. So that's an interesting thing. So the protocol basically was send the command, increase urgency over time until we get the acknowledgement. The acknowledgement was actually the action. This is not dissimilar at all to what's going to happen when we have a vehicle talking to a roadside unit. The canonical example I use is a car coming up to an intersection, and an external device may have more information about what's happening. So the same story plays out kind of in this way. So the vehicle may request instructions how to get to, or route how to get somewhere. So that's consulting Google Maps or whatever. So it's a fairly long process, and we'll get TCP acknowledgments and things like that. So that's getting where we're going. Then we're driving down the street. The infrastructure knows there's kids playing. So when we have kids playing by the side of the road, lower speed. So we're going to send the instruction at lower speed. We get an acknowledgement. We see the car lower its speed. We're happy. So now we have this kid who decides to dart out into the street. And the infrastructure roadside camera may see this. The car may not see it because the kid was occluded by a parked car, so its radar or whatever didn't pick it up. So we want to tell the autonomous vehicle about the kid. So the RSU, which is the roadside unit, basically interprets the image through video it sees this kid, sees the car, says, uh-oh, this is a problem. So over the network, tell the car to stop. Execute emergency stop command. You have a kid you're about to hit. And the car keeps going. It cannot instantaneously execute that command. So what will probably happen is if we're doing 100 frames per second on video from the camera, every 10 milliseconds we're getting a frame, we can detect whether or not the car is slowing down. So every 10 milliseconds we'll reevaluate the situation and send the command again, slow down, slow down, slow down. What we want to happen is eventually the vehicle gets the signal and applies the brakes, do an emergency stop. The infrastructure detects that, and then that's the kind of the implicit acknowledgement that it actually got the signal. So we don't really need the acknowledgement coming back because we're retransmitting the same information anyway, which we would do regardless because we're always reevaluating the situation. So there's a lot of parallels here, but you see different types of communication. So one is the normal act-based communication. One is this part of communication where we're getting input from the physical world that provides acts, and we're correlating this information. So I believe that kind of underscores that we have possibilities of different types of protocols coming for this. And with that, that's all I had.
I think all these technological aspects are interesting, but at some point we're going to have to deal with the liability aspects of having all this infrastructure and these things that, well, I think the most important thing was the slide where you said that the criticalness of the operation can go all the way to life and death. So over time in history, when we've had a new technology show up that can potentially harm life or property, what ends up happening? You have any idea? What's the common thread amongst new pieces of technology that can harm life or property? They get regulated.
What is it?
So like when we had commercial air traffic first, we regulated it. Anything that comes along like this cars, they're regulated. Trains, things like this, and this is the next thing that's gonna get regulated.
There is definitely in public infrastructure, the regulations are high. There are still, for instance, in New York, there are still mechanical function traffic lights on relays. However, if you look, especially autonomous vehicles, people are pushing the limits with technology. So, for instance, I think Google or Tesla or Uber, I think Uber was the one, they're trying to get permits now to allow their cars to roam the streets without drivers. So I would suggest a few movies. So one is iRobot, which really frames the problem in an interesting way. It's both hopeful and not hopeful. Terminator is a little more negative. Well, they actually did another study. It's like one out of every two people believe that eventually the machines will rise and Terminator will become true. It's getting kind of scary. So on one hand, kind of funny, I look at this and I see how rudimentary we are. We talk about all this fancy networking. We're still having problems at a conference getting Wi-Fi to work.
Right.
So that doesn't give me a lot of confidence. On the other hand, the fact that we are able to do what we do and people are smart make me think that we can solve this. Regulation is actually a mixed blessing, right? I mean, you can't allow people to do whatever they want. We have to regulate just the wire spectrum or the frequency spectrums and things like that. But I think the important thing is the expectation that these things will affect us as kernel engineers. I don't think we can detach ourselves from the problem too much longer. Either we're part of the solution or be completely bypassed in some sense, but I think being part of the solution is actually the more likely thing.
I think that's true. I just worry that things like the update problem and exploits like that, I hope no one dies before we get the regulation we need to prevent that kind of stuff from happening.
It may require, well, that's the irony. We're never going to take these things seriously as a society, like privacy and upgrades, until something bad happens and you have lawsuits and litigation. Unfortunately, that's a fact of reality.